Dear all who are participating today in my little talk I'm going to give you on landscaping and my experiences I'll share with you. First of all, let me thank the provincial of Jesuits province in Goa, Father Roland Coelho, and Dr. Emilia Mascarenhas, and also Dr. Frederick Norona for making this possible and for inviting me to talk today. I would like to introduce myself to you, those who do not know me. There are a few I have seen who are known to me. Well, my name is Rosendo Mendonca. I'm from Giri. I'm the founder of Mr. Farmer Company. It's a nursery, and we have a nursery, and we have other activities like landscaping, and we have irrigation, and we have engineering division. We have a farm. And now, some years ago, we have changed Mr. Farmer to in private limited company. And my son Sachin added lots to this, and basically he looks after this operation today. Well, as far as my education is concerned, I did my BSc Agriculture in 1974 at University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore. My pet subject was horticulture, and I majored in horticulture. And this facility was given by the university during the last fourth year. What I enjoyed most there, besides lectures and practicals, we had our own garden there, and I used to work there with my colleagues. And I gained a lot of experience also from those students who are doing post-graduation. And I used to work with them. I used to do all their experiments. I gained in the bargain, and I got good knowledge in horticulture. And when I finished in 74, 75, I joined agriculture department for very few days, and then joined Zuari Agrochemicals and worked there for about 3.5 years. Then I started my business in full swing. Besides my business and horticulture, I have a passion for the blind. I'm part of National Association for the Blind Goa State Branch, and I've been the president for the last almost 20 years. And I've been working for the blind for the last more than 25 years. I was also given an award by the state government for my works there. And then my business started, and we got married and grew, my company grew big, and we are doing well in horticulture especially. Well, let's come to today's topic. Landscaping for a beautiful neighborhood. When I look at this neighborhood, when we call neighborhood, we talk about not only of one landscaping of one house or two houses. We also should look at the streets, the roads, beautification of open spaces, and the roads also. So I what is important is to create a landscape, meaning we use lots of plants, trees, shrubs, ground covers, lawns, and the whole landscaping is divided into hard landscape and soft landscape. Both are equally important. Now, the hard landscape covers the roads, the footpaths, the swimming pools, the fountains, the waterfalls, statues, artifacts, swings. And the soft landscape takes care of all types of plants, ground covers, lawns also. Now, how do we go about to do landscaping? I'll just give an example. I'm invited by a client to do the landscaping. For example, we'll take a residential house. How do you go about what to plant and where to plant and how much to plant? You have to conceive an idea, a concept before you do anything. So a lot of discussion with the client. It is very important to know the needs of the client. It is not my need. We can do so many things, but it is important the final result should be the need of the client. So it is important to have lots of meetings to know the taste of the customer and what he would like to have in his own garden. After that is done, you make a plan. How do you conceive that idea? See, suppose a man wants to get married to a girl. Unless he sees the girl or the girl sees the boy, they cannot make a decision. So to conceive that idea, you have to see the house or the new building. And it's not enough to see within that area only. You must see what is happening outside the compound of this client. Whether there are big trees, on which north, east, west is very important. Which side the wind blows and which side the sun comes. All these factors are important to conceive a concept to do the landscape. The next step is you make a small note and say these are the trees that will suit your place and present it to the customer. Once he says yes, also we must give suggestions to the customer. And today's landscaping, it is not only just trees and shrubs and lawns. There are about 15, 20 years ago, I have introduced fruit trees. Now most of them do it. Fruit trees, vegetables, should be part of the landscape. So the first part is the hard landscape. You make a design or make a sketch and give it to the customer to execute them. Once that implementation is over of the hard landscape, remember I mentioned should be the roads, the footpaths, the swimming pool, all this must be ready before we venture into the soft landscaping. Once that is done, while that is being done, you prepare the list of trees and shrubs and again present it and explain to the customer the types of trees that you want to plant and why they are being planted. In normal cases, I would like to tell you that most customers give a huge list. They have a small, hardly 200 square meters of land, but they'll give you 5 coconut trees, 2 mango trees. It goes on like this. But it is not possible. We explain to the customer, within the space, you can get this number of trees, this number of shrubs, and the ground towers and this much lawn. So that's how the next step goes. And once this is done, you work out the costs of other materials that are required for soft landscaping. Normally, the hard landscaping is executed by the client. The soft landscape, once you prepare the list of plants, trees, shrubs, ground covers, the next step is to calculate how much soil, manure, and sand and other requirement. Now, we need garden soil. Very often we are questioned when we deliver the soil. He says, you have brought in so much of stones in this soil. But I would like to tell all of you that soil without stone is no good soil. We must have small stones, and that is very important to keep the soil friable, and because the roots need to breathe. Very important. If you have, for example, soil brought in without stone, which is clay, it becomes very hard. And all the plants suffer because of that. So the best thing to do is to get good garden soil. Now, how do you recognize good garden soil? It is mainly the top soil of the hilly areas. There are suppliers who supply you. Up to 2 meters, it is very good. And you need organic matter with this. Soil alone is not sufficient. Then the organic matter, you can use cow dung, which we call farmyard manure. Then the compost you can use. You can make your own compost and use it. There's vermicompost. Neem cake is also used. Neem cake is not only manure, but is also repellent to many insects. So pest control is important, and nutrition is important in this mixture. We call it garden mix. So the proportion, ideal proportion for Goan soils is 6 parts of garden soil, 2 parts of cow dung manure or compost, 1 part of sand, but that sand should be coarse sand. Never use fine sand, which is useless. It's difficult to get sand today and it's very expensive, but it is worth it. Or you have to have little more stones in your soil if you want to avoid the cost. So this is a, then you have to add to this mixture some pesticides. And you know, conditioners, you know, Goan soils are very acidic. So some quantity of lime added to this mixture is very good. You take up the pH. Once, then the next step would be for landscaping, soft landscaping, you have to clear the whole area from some debris, some stones, or some concrete lying there, or any other material that is lying in the landscape area. Once that is done, you do grading of the soil or formation of the ground. The formation is what? It should be done in such a way that extra water, rain water, drains off very easily. Remember one thing, watering plants in excess and not watering, result is same, the plants die. So do not allow water to stagnate in the landscaping area. That's how very important is to do the formation of the ground. While doing the formation of the ground, you must remember that you're going to receive that garden mix that you have prepared. Under normal conditions, we use 6 inches layer all over of this garden mix. And we check the levels to make sure that the drainage is done properly before planting the trees. That's a very simple method to use. And then you use your labor and relay completely the soil mix required. The next part is now the planting. While you prepare for planting, the size of pits are important. Along the coastal areas, for example, for a tree of about 6 feet, 7 feet tall, a pit of 2 by 2 by 2 feet would be sufficient. Remember, I'm talking about the sandy belt. If you're on the hillside and it's just a soft laterite, 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter cubic meter for big trees. If there's hard rock, I advise many times to go in for 1.5 meter by 1.5 meter by, and the depth is 1.5 meter. It is an expensive job, but once done, your plants remain happy for at least 25 years. Very often, people make small khaddas or small pits and plant them. As the plant grows, it remains stunted, it withers, quite often it dies, doesn't fruit also properly. So very important to have these basic things, to have big pits in hilly region. Then what do you fill those pits? Let's come to only the tree planting now, not the shrubs. Once the pits are made, fill the pits with the good garden mix that you have prepared. Not completely full, leave it about 1 foot down because you need a space for planting. A little bit of caution on planting of trees I would like to mention here, though it's a more horticultural job. See, normally we have plants in the plastic bags. Avoid bringing plants for planting, transplanting in pots, because it's difficult to cut the pots and remove the plant to plant it in the pit. Because very often, the ball of earth which is there, it breaks and the tree gets affected. May not die, but it will shed all its leaves. And by the time it produces new leaves, you lose some time. And when the tree is planted in the center of the pit, the soil has to be firmed well, fill in more soil, and you can add a little more manure, organic manure, and water it immediately. Once it is watered, after some time, if there are tall trees, more than 5 feet or 10 feet, staking is very important. So you use bamboos or any poles and stake them so they don't get disturbed. Remember, when the plants are planted, you need to take this care. At least for 6 months, stake them, then you can remove the sticks. By then they'll form their own roots outside that region which of that bag that you remove the plant from. So formation of the soft landscape are the trees. Once you finish all the trees, you have to dream. You know, even if you have a plan, you visit that place and look at the trees, whether it is doing a proper function as per your plan. Many times you need to make a change because you're not happy with what you planted. It needs a change, you make the change. It's worth it. And once the tree planting is done, first job is over. What kind of trees that you would select in our region? Remember, use only tropical trees. And try and get more established trees. Don't go small seedling, which takes many years to grow and get a good effect of landscaping. So one part is over now. Then second part is the shrubbery. When you choose shrubs, you must use both foliage and the flowering shrubs. I forgot to mention here, even the trees, you should not have all flowering or all foliage. You must have some flowering, some foliage, and some fruiting trees, and some palms if you want to have, especially coconut. Of course, there are some beautiful ornament palms which you can add. If it is a small garden, I would like to mention, do not use bamboos if it is a small garden, because the roots of bamboos travel from one end to another end. The other tree that you should avoid, any ficus. You know, ficus was so popular about 15 years ago. There was no garden without ficus trees. You know, you could get green, different shape of leaves, and colors. People were very excited about ficus. But today, at least I have stopped totally using ficus plants in landscape. But bamboos, we do use where the area is large. They're beautiful. Bamboos are very beautiful. There are at least 30, 40 varieties available here. You can use it in your landscape. They're very beautiful. Then also, the trees, you must also select some trees with fragrant flowers. You know, most people want to have some fragrance in their garden. In shrubbery also, you can get like night queen, for example. Here and there, if you plant in your landscape, which is worth it. But there are also some plants which give you fragrance during the day. Even some lantanas. New lantana there, they do give some fragrance even during the day. So once you select your shrubbery, get it planted. You don't require very big pits, just 1.5 feet by 1.5 feet or 1 foot by 1 foot is sufficient. So plan as per the design you like. And as I mentioned earlier, if you're not happy with what you have done, don't do it the same day, go after 2, 3 days and dream about the whole landscape. That is where you'll find that there are some errors. Do the changes. Then after shrubs, we call them ground covers, which are smaller plants which are required to cover the grounds of the trees at the base of the trees and cover the ground. Lawn also is a ground cover. But lawn is used for different purposes. Ground covers you can get also flowering and non-flowering also. That's based on your taste and liking, and how much you can maintain in future also is very important to increase the number of plants in your garden. Then there comes lawn. In Goa there are two most important lawns that are grown. One is the Mexican grass, very common, and it is available in all the nurseries. And it comes in carpet forms or sods, we call it. You can get 2 feet by 1 foot or 6 feet by 1 foot. The longer, it is better. So you have to perfectly level the ground the way you want. If you want a mound, you create a mound which looks good. Like, for example, you take a picture of the hills around, especially this, you just take a picture anywhere in Goa, it's so beautiful. And if you want to create some little mounds in your garden, if you have a larger area, you can. Don't go for too big mounds, just 1.5 feet or so, that would be enough. And after you level it properly, you also add little more compost on the surface of the soil, that garden mix that you use, and relay these sheets the way you want, because they in hardly 15-20 days time they join. Then you don't know, you can't make out that you had planted those sheets there of lawn. Now the other this Mexican lawn is good where there is plenty of sunlight. You cannot grow in the shade. Many people do it in partial shade, but it doesn't do so well. The other lawn that we commonly use is crab grass. Somebody called me the other day and says, I want elephant grass. Maybe they call it elephant grass. It's a broadleaf grass, which is common in Goa. I recommend that a lot in partial shade and not too much shade. If it is, there is too much shade, it grows vertical, doesn't spread. So avoid growing in total shade under the trees this particular grass, crab grass. It doesn't mean that you leave that place open. There are many shade-loving plants, small plants like aglaonemums, some philodendron which trail on the ground. They love shade. They do very well in such areas. Don't make circles in your garden. Make very informal, you see, because the whole landscape in the world is informal. Though in landscaping, we have formal landscaping and informal. I only do informal gardens. I hate to do the straight lines or hedges. Not that we don't grow hedges, but for some purpose we use it. Not as a design. But you see, they are also called Mughal gardens, the formal gardens. If you go to Delhi, you find lots of them. Because the climatic condition probably, and people love those things. But I found in Goa, people like very informal gardens and is doing well. Now, I was talking to you about fruiting trees, vegetables. There was a time people used to earmark, okay, this is a kitchen garden. This is a herb garden. I have changed this concept totally. You know how beautiful a tomato plant or brinjal plant, I'll just give an example of these two. Those plants themselves, they are shrubs and they're beautiful. And when they're in fruiting stage, it is so beautiful. So don't go have a special place for these vegetables. Plant them among your shrubs. Let it be part of the landscape. What is there if you have two tomato plants here and somewhere else to plant? Make sure there is sunlight. All vegetables love and herbs love sunlight. So you can grow herbs as ground covers. They look so beautiful, and you can also use in the kitchen. Chili plants, there are varieties of chilies. Also include in your landscape where there is shrubbery and where there is sunlight. And coriander, for example, that also can be planted. Because these are useful things and every day in your kitchen. You don't have to go to the market all the time. Chilies, for example, you plant 2-3 varieties and you have chilies every day. Tomatoes, we do have a problem. Brinjal do grow in monsoon also, but tomatoes don't like this heavy rain. But we can grow cluster beans and radish, okra, lady's fingers, they just grow. Pumpkins, all this can be grown in your own landscape. Don't have a special place. And that makes the whole place a unique place. It combines with everything. I would like to tell you at this junction, what happens with the plants? I talk to my plants. Many of you must be doing the same thing. It takes many years to understand their language. Wherever, sometimes people call me as a consultant to find out what is the problem in their garden. Before I talk to the customer, I go and take a quick round in the garden. I get all the complaints told to me by plants. So, and I confirm this with the customer, and he says, this is true. How do you know? It's difficult. You try it out, you'll be able to do it. Why it is important to talk to plants and love the plants? Because I'll give you one example of a landscape I had done in Miramar many years ago. Two houses, duplex with a common wall, two ladies. They were very excited with all what I was doing. After 6 months, one lady calls me up. She says, my plants are not in my neighbors. You didn't see any. Why my plants are not doing well? I said, I gave her a date and time. I went there. I asked a few questions, and I knew that she hardly went out. She depended on that gardener who came. Whereas the other lady used to go out 3-4 times a day. And believe me, the lady used less manure, less pesticides, but her plants were shining. But the other side was a disaster. So I explained to her, if you do this, the prescription I give you, try it out, try hard and honest. And she did it, believe me. And things changed. She could not believe that you can address the plants, communicate with them. It's a magic. For example, my own house, I have a garden. My garden is also looks like a little nursery also. There are too many plants. This is my passion. I like to collect all the new plants and I keep them at home. When they are propagated and when we have a few extra, I do sell them. Now coming back to our landscape, now we have finished planting trees, the hard landscape is ready, swimming pool is ready, the children play, the swings, everything is ready. Now who is going to look after this? That's a big task. That is as big as preparing the garden and doing all the planting. If that is neglected, all your money gone down to the drain. So how do you maintain, if it is a house and you don't want to engage a gardener, you want to do yourself? First of all, we give them always a little prescription when we finish the garden. In terms of implements, in terms of manures, in terms of pesticides, the frequency they have to use. And we follow sometimes, but we give them free advice. They call us a phone and send us the pictures. Now the facility is so good, you take a picture next second, it is there with us. So we do this type of help wherever we have done the garden. But many of them have become experts, and I also learn from them. You know, there is always space for learning. You know, my university did not teach me everything, lectures are there, but I learned from my own mother, who was a great gardener. And my father used to love trees, fruit trees. He was not interested in other plants. So, and I learned from farmers, I learned from small gardeners. So this is how we get there. That's why I'm sharing my knowledge with you, because I feel happy to share. And I hope all of you will benefit. Now, maintenance of the garden. One important thing I would like to tell all of you. Most people do not feed their plants. You know, when we go there, we ask, when did you put manure? Some 6 months ago. I ask them, how many times do you eat per day? You give them at least once a month good manure or fertilizer. And today, everybody wants organic. You can use both organic and inorganic. Pesticides also, we have organic today. and inorganic also. So maintenance of lawn in particular, I tell you, this especially Mexican lawn does get affected by insects, even by termites. So once in 3 months, you have to treat the lawn area with plant pesticides. Please do not call your pest control person and tell him that this is the problem. He'll burn all your lawn. Those pesticides are not meant for this. Plant pesticides are available. They're available in many places. And there's one more thing in landscaping, new thing. It's a talk of the town. Everybody wants it. It's a vertical gardens. I'm sure some of you, at least, or green wall, they call it. It is nothing but if you want to screen somebody, or you don't want to see your neighbor, or you don't want to see the road, you need to have a metallic structure done on those. There are panels fixed, and individual pots are fixed on that, and you get a beautiful vertical wall with plants. Variety of plants can be planted there. They remain small because the containers are small, and the medium of planting is not our soil, the mixture which I told you for gardening. You can use cocoa peat, then use vermicompost in that, and cocoa chips, you know, cocoa peat and cocoa coconut. Cocoa chips are small pieces out of the sonna, if all of you know coconut, out of shell. That's cut into small bits. There's a process. And that mixed with cocoa peat and vermicompost, sufficient. And that is also very light, and you don't need to water every day because the retention of water is very high there. So that is something new that has come, and it's happening all over. So it's not difficult at all. So I just want to conclude, say this landscaping is not a nuclear science. You have to have a relationship with the plants, the soft landscape, and with your own experience, you can do many things in your garden. Pot culture is one more thing as part of the Goan, I must say, Goan landscape. Many, even Portuguese time and after Portuguese, even now, they have little pots mounted on some stonework and kept on top. Maybe ferns or a little bougainvillea, ixoras. You know, that throws little color in the garden. That is a Goan style totally. I have not seen anywhere. So you can be your own creator of your garden. You don't, of course, if you need help, there are professionals. And sometimes it is worth it, because don't make unnecessary mistakes. If you're a beginner, then you learn on your own to look after your garden. With this, I think I have conveyed most of the things in brief, because landscape is a huge subject. And now, I'll tell you, when I started in 74, nobody wanted landscaping. They're saying, we have to buy the plants, because Goans were used to just breaking a twig and taking it free of cost. So they said that, but that was common, nothing wrong. But slowly people got used to buying plants from the nurseries. And now you have nurseries everywhere, and there are enough plants. But I like to mention here, our nursery is very unique. We have plants with us, not available every day, but we do sell them. Exotic plants Of course, they're expensive, but there are collectors in Goa. They come from not only from Goa, they come from Calcutta. I have customers in Tamil Nadu and Bombay. They come to my nursery only for this. Of course, there are Goan group also, lover of plants. You know, they just want that plant. We sometimes exchange some plants which we don't have. Of course, that is required. And this group is doing well. And this is a new plants. I'll mention one or two plants. There's one tree called Amhersia nobilis. Only we have this tree for sale for a couple of years. Amhersia nobilis is called the queen of all the trees. A little history about this. It came from Burma to Calcutta. It was gifted by the queen of Burma to Viceroy in Calcutta in 1946. The first plant, but did not multiply for years because one could produce only from the seeds. What happens when you grow any plant like mango also from the seed? It takes many years, even up to 20 years to give the fruit. The new technique of grafting this Amhersia nobilis came very recently, about 7, 8 or 10 years ago. And that's how I got the first plant from, not from Calcutta, unfortunately. I've ordered many times, I got the wrong plants. But it happens like that. Because in the same family, there are other plants. Well, let me thank all the listeners. And if you have some questions, I'm prepared to address those. Am I audible? Can somebody? Okay. Where is, I don't see the chat box. But if you can read it, it'll be fast. Yeah. Okay, I'll answer the second question first. There's only one agriculture college in Goa, that is in Solkorna, Don Bosco's. And my friend Miguel was responsible for starting this college. And as far as horticulture courses are concerned, I think ICR Old Goa as a horticulture course, they may not have, they'll have, say, about mango growing, something like that, individual courses, they should have by Indian Council of Agriculture Research and the ICAR in Old Goa. Yeah. What is?
Staking.
What is the question again? What's staking? I'll tell you. Okay. Before that, I must tell you, I was talking about the courses. I do conduct some small one-day programs like this in my nursery. If any one of you all want to join, contact Savio, now that you all know Savio, and I'll have a special one-day session for you. Staking, stakes means just dandas, a pole or bamboo or any tree. Now, the size of the pole also is important. Suppose the tree is, say, 10 feet.
There is no need of having 10 feet tall stake. If you get about 7 feet, but remember, 2 feet will go in the ground. When you cut, you must remember that. Otherwise, you cut 7 feet, then you'll get only 5 feet. So, when you introduce that in the ground, it should be firm, straight. And one important tip I'll give you. What people do, just take a rope and tie it around that pole and the tree. What happens to that loop? It goes up and down with the wind or whatever. It gets loose and it rubs against the tree and creates a problem for the tree. So what you have to do, always remember when you do staking, tie one knot to the stake, the pole, then take it around the tree branch and make a knot. Don't make it very tight. It's dangerous afterwards. This girl who asked this question, is clear? Very good question. See, at least to my knowledge, no. I have seen few Ratnagiri farms in Goa. I would not plant because they don't do well here. That's my experience. Maybe others can share. It does. See, this damage to the plants are done not only by the trees that you have grown there, by your own house, the roof, the water dropping just cuts the plants completely. But that we have to bear with it. And every year we have to redo that area. You don't have to buy plants. So the same plants you can propagate and plant it. There's no cost involved. But this, it is like part of our life. We are in the tropical region and it rains. And these damages do happen. It does. Anyway, even shrubbery can snakes can hide there. In my own house, I have lots of snakes, but we don't kill them. We should not worry about so much. But if you are worried, you spray your garden every 15 days, especially the not the trees, the especially the ground covers and shrubs. That deters them. Two questions. One is how to keep away the ants from the vegetable. Ants do not come to attack your vegetables at all. They come to eat. You know that you have already, whenever you see ants on your vegetable plant, means there are sucking insects already on that plant. What they exudate now, honeydew it is called, they come to eat that. Directly ants don't destroy your plants. But you have to get rid of those sucking insects by using any systemic insecticides, whether it is inorganic or organic. You're talking about calcium, particularly. Calcium is required in Goa, including for paddy growing. If you do that, your yield goes up. Same thing with vegetables. If you want to use calcium, prepare the beds, spring few days, mix it up nicely, and you start planting vegetables. It is good. Calcium is not only brings the pH up, it is also one of the nutrients plants need. get rid of.
Hello.
Yes. See, don't get there's no need of getting rid of. If they're on the vegetable, or she's talking, they're in the garden all over. What is the question? Vegetable?
It's a vegetable,
No.
vegetable.
Same, see, why ants come there, I explained just now, to eat that honeydew from those sucking insects. But if you get rid of those sucking insects, aphids especially, by if you want to use organic, systemic insecticides are available. We have. You can come to my nursery if you are close by. Yeah, sour soap is very common. Okay, I'll tell you what happens in sour soap. What is called mealy bugs. Now, white ants is different from other, not the red ants she's talking. White ants everywhere there are. Even white ants you can get, I mean, you can't get rid of them. You know why? We have encroached in their property. So it is their land, even insect, snakes, no? I tell people, this was not your land, this was a snake land. You have come inside here in their property and build a house. So you have to bear with it. Now, anyway, the sour soap, I want to tell you what happens. This is very common with sour soap, crotons, hibiscus. You know, there is an insect called mealybugs. And when you see, it looks like some cotton on the tree. And by that cotton, the mealybugs are sucking insects. What happens, you know, when you spray any, if you spray any contact insecticide, it just falls on that white cover. That is their self-protection. They are very happy inside the sucking, the sap of the plant. To get rid of them, you have to use systemic only insecticides. Even sour soap, this is a very common problem. You can spray directly on the fruit when it's small. And if you are using organic, you can spray the previous day also and eat next day. Lime plants, okay. In general, all trees, if they are very big trees, no, like mangoes, which are 60, 70 years old, twice a year is enough. But if they are new plants which you have planted, which are hardly 3-4 years, I would suggest if you feed every month, it's golden. You'll get the best results. Yeah, natural pesticides are today available. Earlier we had only neem. We used to use neem. Neem is one of the insecticides that we use. But there are now new organic insecticides available. All this is available today in the market. Or as I said, you can come to us. We will show you what to do with this type of problem. You can send me the pictures and I'll tell you what to spray. No, this is a problem in Goa. First of all, there are two plants we must not grow in Goa. One is papaya, and other plant you should not grow roses. People are very, they take a rose plant from the nursery, they plant it. After 6 months, I mean, go and see what is the state of that plant. Papayas, I also grow, but I'll tell you how we manage at home. See, papayas, roots are very sensitive, and it doesn't like rain. Some good papayas I've seen grown on the slopes of the hill. They hate water. Wet feet is no good for them. So I don't know where you're located, but if you're located in the plains, then you should avoid growing papayas because there's a root rot. Even overnight daytime, you get fruits. Next morning, you go after breakfast in the garden, papaya is down, gone. And those papayas cannot be eaten also. Very hard. So what we do, my wife does it. When we eat papaya, no, she throws the seeds in the garden. And they grow, some of them grow and give the papaya, but you must never touch their roots. If you try to manure them by digging around, you're finished. The infection sets in and it is dead. You try it out, go up. If you are in Kolhapur, they said it's very good, dry region.
Yes, sir. We need the silver one.
Yeah, you know, the name of our nursery establishment is Mr. Farmer. It is along the National Highway in Giri. If you're coming from Mapsa, first thing you come to a hotel called Green Park. From Green Park, when you come on the National Highway, it is hardly about less than a kilometer from there, to the left. A product, organic product, what detail? See, there are, like inorganic, we have inorganic pesticides, which are systemic and contact also. So depends for what you want to use. These sucking insects are so tiny, microscopic, you have to use systemic insecticides for that. And in terms of cost also, I would like to tell you, organic pesticides are costlier than inorganic. And if they're slow to react, but you get good results. Systemic, what happens? When a systemic insecticide or fungicide is sprayed on the plant, make sure it is not a rainy day. After you spray, at least 3-4 hours must without any char. What happens when you spray that insecticide gets into the body of the plant through the leaves and travels in the tree up and down. So when it reaches the area where the insects are there, they suck, the sucking insect, they suck the sap of the plant, which is good food for them. When they suck, that insecticide is there in that sap. And they eat and they die. That's called systemic. Bananas, no, you can feed every day also. And water plenty. Bananas are heavy feeders. But how to look after them, I will tell you. See, when you plant one banana plant today, it will grow. And within 1 year, you will get the fruit to harvest, most of the bananas. As it grows, you get baby suckers. If you want to do it properly and you want to get good size bananas, you have to retain only one sucker. You have to remove those, cut them off, keep one. And as soon as you harvest the bunch, cut off the main plant which you have planted and allow this sucker to grow. Bananas also, you have to feed them only for 6 months. First 6 months. Afterwards, once the initiation of the bud, we call it, you know, the whole bunch that you see outside, it forms inside the body of the plant. Same thing with mangoes, any fruit plant. So you have to feed every month banana plants with a lot of organic. If you want to use inorganic, it depends on you. But feed well, water plenty. Bananas love water. They can drink any amount of water. And you'll get the best bananas with this But after 6 months, don't waste your money. You know, today there are some, depending on the type of loan, there are some selective weedicides you get. They're inorganic. But to avoid that weeds on the lawn, initially you must take care. Jeff, forgot to mention, good question this is. You know, when you do that mixture which I told you, garden soil, manure, the garden soil that you can't avoid. The weeds come along with that, some weeds. But the manure, if you use cow dung manure, if it is not well decomposed, you get millions of weeds in that. So I suggest if it's a small lawn, use any vermicompost or proto meal is another type of compost that you get. You use that, you'll get less weeds. Best thing to hand weed if it's not too much. If it is fully infested, you know, dig up that area completely up to the depth of 1 foot, throw that whole thing out or bury it somewhere 2 feet down and put lay more soil. I hope that is not a nut grass this gentleman is talking about. Can you ask him whether it's a nut grass? Yes, Zuse? You see the line? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's a typical Goan soil, you know, lawn outside the house. I mean, normal soil.
Yeah. How big is your lawn?
Lawn is, about, say, 20 square meters or so.
I think hand weeding would be the best. Using unnecessary chemicals, I would advise you.
In the rain, and all it has overgrown the lawn.
Yeah, I know. What kind of lawn is this?
I have both Mexican and Mexican and the.
Joseph, I suggest that you hand weed it.
Okay.
Safest.
That's what we have been doing. But,
do that. Yeah.
Talking about some pesticide or so weedicide or something like that. I mean, is that effective?
Weedicide is effective, but you have to buy the selective weedicide. But I was telling you to avoid because you unnecessarily use chemicals in your ground. In very small lawn, that is 20 square meters. If it is 5,000 square meters, 2,000 square meters, people do use weedicides to be. And they are available in the market. And the small strength, 2,4-D, for example, there's a weedicide which can kill and also be a selective weedicide. Correct strength you must use. This could be a physiological disorder. I feel she's located on some hilly area. There's a hard rock there. Something is there, something like that. These are physiological disorders. There could be many.
It's a hilly area. It's a lot of
hard rock. So what do you know? There is a space around it?
Yeah, there is.
Around the tree? What do you do? This happened to me. I'm 40 years ago. There in Porori, he had planted coconuts and they were doing well for about 10 years. And similar thing happened. So he invited me one day. He says, this is the problem, what to do? I got about 50 coconut palms. After 10 years, this is what has happened. I gave one solution. I said, get a couple of truckloads of soil and put it around that diameter of about 4-5 meters around, you know, fill it up to 1 foot. And there is no need of getting very good soil. Even kacha red soil is enough. Believe it or not, in 6 months' time, you should have seen the change in the coconut palms. This is an example I tell many people. And this happened to me, I think, about 40 years ago. Yeah. Martha is right. She knows those places. Coconut putting potash is very important because coconut husk itself has got 22% potash in that. Bilomar, yes. No. You know, there are many things like this. But that's a myth, yeah. People just believe in anything. What can we do? I don't believe. Which mangoes? Neelam is a wild tree of India. It grows anywhere, north to south. It's a wild tree used for a lot of research. Yeah, I take a little time, huh? Because tomatoes, brinjal, lettuce, and should be a winter crop. You should start buying the seed by the end of October. So November you sow the seeds, tomatoes, chilies you can plant throughout the year. Are you on the beach side? Then you can grow tomatoes also there in monsoon. I have grown on the beach. And big crop, I got one of the resorts in South Goa. Directly on the sand. Sorry, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, there's a lot of information with us here. Yeah, we do that. We do terrace gardening also. You know, Savi, you can share my number with all of them.
Yeah,
they can contact me. Yeah. Yeah, because I call it cancer in the garden, you know, bamboo plants. If it is a small garden, and if there is some tree close by, it is bound to suffer from this. Yeah, you can get audio out of it also. But Black insects, I don't know, I didn't understand that question actually.
Yeah, it's a chrysanthemum plant.
Ah, chrysanthemum plant, okay.
Black, they get stuck and remain there and destroy the plant.
No, the most of it, what you're saying, the sucking insects, they don't move, they remain there.
Yes.
So
yes.
Why is spraying any systemic insects that will act?
Okay. Thank you.
Is a tough job.
Yes.
No. You have to have contact insects. They spray directly on that. Don't remove, just spray, that will by itself will go from there. Yeah. spray on the nest, ant's nest. What to manure lime with, no? Okay. Not fruiting could be there's reasons. One reason could be if it is a grafted plant, or we call it budding also, very often the wild shoot grows and it grows so fast compared to the grafted scion, we call it, and that scion dies and you wait for limes to come. It happens with mangoes also. But this is, unless you see, check, examine this, it will be difficult. 3 years, I hope she has got enough sunlight. That's the first thing important. Limes, if it is a grafted, you know, you can get limes in 2 years plenty. Grafted can be layered also. It's called gutti. That also produces the same results. A pineapple should give fruit within 1 year. If it is a sucker, if it is a crown, it takes about 1.5 years. Thank you. In the form, in the pedifields. Yeah, you can grow. Even if it slightly gets flooded, no, nothing happens, they grow. But you must raise it slightly. You must take the soil from there only, you don't have to get from out. You can also get it, but you can use the same soil, raise it to about 1.5 feet from the ground. And plant it. But what is most important after planting, you protect it with some kind of coconut leaves. You know, it is like a baby in the womb. You know, baby in the womb has a protection. Same thing happens to these plants. When they are planted there, if they are not protected or left open for the winds and storms, they don't do well. They get frightened. But if you take care for 2-3 years, no? 3 years you don't have to cover. You have to cover it for about 1.5 year, maximum 2 years. And what to be watered on regular basis. Yeah. Monsoon lots you can grow. Bendis is one. Lady's fingers. Pumpkins you can grow. Then I have grown also cluster beans. You can grow even radish you can grow. And tamati bhaji, green bhaji, very common. You just throw it, comes up. And I, please share. And I must thank you and the whole organization for having me on this, your program.
Yeah, sure. We have two more events coming up in line. So I'll be just sharing with you all about it. Okay, so this is our CLC website and we have two more events, that is Amchi Mati and Revival of Agriculture by Father Glomax. So the registrations are still open for this event, which is going to be tomorrow. And day after tomorrow, we have another event by Gabriel De Cruz, that is on seaweed and biodiversity conservation. So both the events registrations are still open. You can register yourself and attend these events tomorrow and day after tomorrow. Thank you. I'll be sharing with you all the phone number and phone number of Rosendo sir and the YouTube link to the recorded video. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you. All right.